Hi, Isaac here. Today I'm looking at fair valuation of NCI to fair value of NCI. In our previous tutorials under principles of consolidation, we saw that there are two different ways of valuing NCI. So when it comes to valuation of NCI, we say there is the first method, which is the proportion of net assets method, and then there is also the fair value method. Now we saw the proportion of net assets method in our previous tutorials. Today I'm going to concentrate on how to value NCI using the fair value method. Now, to value NCI using the fair value method, you need to be provided with the market value of NCI at the time when the parent gained control in the subsidiary. So, with our illustration, I'm going to assume a figure for NCI's market. From our previous illustration, we had certain information that was used in calculating the proportion of net assets for NCI. I'm going to use the same information. In that tutorial, we saw that cost of investments for parents was provided as 900,000 cedis. We also saw pre-acquisition income surplus was provided as 120,000. Then pre-acquisition capital surplus was given as 30,000. Now, in the same tutorials, we also saw that on the date of consolidation, so date of consolidation, the income surplus was given as 300,000, and then the capital surplus was given as 50,000. Then our equity capital was given as 800,000, and this equity capital is at a price of 1 cedi per share. So I'm going to use this information for the purpose of our illustration. Like I said earlier, in order to use the fair value method, you have to be given the market price of NCI at the date when parents gain control. So let's assume that the market value per share in NCI is given as 1 cedi 40 pesos. If that is the case, what is the value of NCI? I'm going to prepare the cost of control account again, and then I will also prepare the NCI account. To prepare the cost of control account, now I know the total value of NCI at the time when parent gained control. I know that parent has 80% and that was provided. So P has 80% in equity. So NCI has 20%. If NCI has 20%, how many shares does that translate into? And what is the value of that shares? So we are going to say number of shares for NCI is calculated as, there are 800,000 shares and NCI has 20% of that. So that gives us a total of 160,000 shares. So therefore, what is the value of NCI? To get a value of NCI, obviously we have to multiply the number of shares by the price per share, which is 1 cedi 40 pesos. So that will give us 160,000 times 1 cedi
40 pesos per share. So this is giving us 224,000.
So what this means is that the value of NCI is 224,000 cedis as at the date when parent was gaining control in subsidiary. I'm going to use these figures for the purpose of determining the total value of NCI at the date of consolidation. But to start with, I would prepare the cost of control account. I must admit there are several methods or several styles in presenting this. I'm going to adopt the vertical method and I'm going to adopt an approach for the purpose of calculating this. So this is my cost of control accounts. So I'll bring my city sign appropriately. As usual, I'll start with cost of investments. Cost of investments, there is a cost of investments by the parents and there's also cost of investment by NCI. So how much is the cost of investment by parents? We are giving that as 900,000 and that would always appear on the balance sheet of the parents. Then we just calculated the value of NCI and we had an amount of 224,000, which is 160,000 shares in subsidiary times a market price of 140 pesos per share, giving us 224,000. So if we have 224,000, what will be the total? The total, which is the sum of this, is 1,124,000. At the end of it all, parents has 900,000 investments and NCI has 224,000 also investment in the subsidiary. So the total value of subsidiary is 1,124. The question is, what is the net asset of subsidiary that is actually represented by this value? So we are going to present our net assets. So net assets. Since I'm using total value, means I'm picking the total net asset. So I'll start with my total equity capital. At this point, I don't need to calculate 80% or 20%. I'm picking the whole 100% because this value represents 100% valuation of the subsidiary. So my equity capital is provided as 800,000. Then we are going to add to this our pre-acquisition income surplus, which is provided as 120,000. So that 120,000 will be brought here. Then we have pre-acquisition capital surplus, which is also provided as 30,000. So we'll bring that 30,000 here. Of course, all these are deduction because we have a total valuation of 1,124 for a total acquisition of this much. So we are going to look out for what is the total value of net assets that has been acquired by the parent and also by NCI. 124,000 has gone in to acquire the sum of this, which gives us 950,000. So there is total net assets of 950,000. If we have 950,000 total net assets, but we have paid a total of 1,124,000 to acquire this, the excess of purchase consideration, in this case total purchase consideration, because it is a sum of the purchase consideration for parents and that of NCI, over the fair value of the net assets of the subsidiary is what we are calling goodwill. So the difference of 174,000 represents a goodwill. So in our situation here, there is a goodwill of 174,000. In our previous illustration, we saw that yes, there is an impairment of goodwill. So I'm going to bring impairment of We were provided with an impairment of goodwill, which represents 30%. So we are going to calculate that 30%. So let me do 30% of 174,000, which gives us 52,200. So of the 174,000, 52,200 has been impaired. So we are left with a difference of 121,800, which gives me my goodwill balance carried down, which will have to be sent to the statement of financial position. Now, there are certain things here that we would have to look at. The goodwill as computed actually represents the total goodwill for the subsidiary, and it represents goodwill that is partly for parents and partly for subsidiary, NCI. Now, if that is the case, when there is an impairment of goodwill, we are going to apportion the impairment of goodwill between parents and NCI in accordance with their respective percentages of ownership in the subsidiary. You recollect that when we're looking at the proportion of net assets method, any impairment of goodwill was entirely given to parents. In fact, it was written to the debit of the consolidated income surplus. In this particular instance, what we are going to do is we will split the goodwill between parents' portion, which is 80%, and then NCI's portion, which will represent 20%. Now, to do that, we say this impairment of goodwill, NCI, will take 20% of 52,200, and then parents will take 80% of 52,200. We are doing this split because NCI is being valued at fair value method, and using the fair value method, it means that part of the goodwill impaired would have to be given to NCI. And then our parent will also have to take. So 20% will go to this, and that is 10,440. So we charge 10,440 to NCI, and we charge 41,760 to parents. So that represents 80%, and this one represents 20%. Now the 10,440 would have to go to the NCI account. The 41,760 will have to go to the consolidated income surplus. Now, to show the NCI account, so this is my non-controlling interest account. What we'll do is that we'll start off with the value of NCI. Like I said earlier, there are several ways of presenting this. I'm going to go by this approach. I'm going to start with the value of NCI. When you come to the cost of control, cost of investment, NCI's value is 220. So I put the value of NCI. So at the time of acquisition, it was 224,000. So it is the same value as I'm shown up there. Now what we're going to do is that once we have shown, and let me be quick in saying that this one is a correspondent entry for that amount here. This was debited to cost of control accounts and it's been credited. So it's basically a double entry that has been passed. This is the value of NCI at the time of acquisition. So to determine the value of NCI at the time of consolidation, all I'm going to do is to add the post-acquisition change in value of NCI. Sorry, post-acquisition change in value of the subsidiary. So what is the post-acquisition change in value? It basically is coming from things like post-acquisition income surplus, post-acquisition capital surplus, post-acquisition changes in any surplus. Then of course, since there has been an impairment of goodwill, which also happened after acquisition, that would also come in here. So after bringing the value of NCI at the date of acquisition, all I'm going to add is post-acquisition changes in the value of the subsidiary. And of course, NCI is entitled to only 20% of all those change acquisition. So I'm going to put here post-acquisition income surplus. Now, how do we determine the post-acquisition income surplus? We know that at the date of consolidation,
the income surplus amount is given as 300,000. At the date of acquisition, the amount is 120,000. So we find the difference between the two, which is 80,000. NCI is entitled to 20% of the post acquisition income surplus. Is the difference between the income surplus on the date of consolidation, which is 300,000, and the income surplus on the date of acquisition. So the difference is 180,000. We calculate 20% of 180,000, that gives us 36,000. So it means that the value of NCI has increased by 36,000, which is the post-acquisition increment in the subsidiary that belongs to NCI. In addition, there's also post-acquisition capital surplus. So let me do the computation down here. Again, on the date of consolidation, we are giving the capital surplus to be 50,000. On the date of acquisition, we are giving capital surplus of 30,000. Meaning there is a difference of 20,000. That 20,000 is what we are calling the post-acquisition capital surplus. And NCI is entitled to 20% of that. So 20% of 20,000, that gives us 4,000. Now, 4,000 plus 36,000 plus that will give us the total value. But remember, when we computed goodwill, there was an impairment of 52,200. Impairment in value of goodwill represents a reduction, it represents a loss. So that loss would also have to reduce the value of NCI. When we did a computation, we realized that of the 52,200, 10,440 actually is attributed to NCI. So we come here and say impairment of goodwill. The portion that belongs to NCI is 10,440. And since impairments are losses, it will be a deduction. So now what we'll do is that we are going to sum up everything, all that, and that will give us the total value of our NCI, which is provided as 253,560. So putting everything together, we'll get 253,560. So this is the value of our NCI. So NCI balance carried out as at the date of consolidation is 253,560. All we've done is to pick the value of NCI at the date of acquisition. Then we added to this the post-acquisition change in the value of our subsidiary, or post-acquisition change in the surpluses of our subsidiary. We bring that one here. And of course, since NCI is entitled to only 20% of our subsidiary, we calculate 20% of all those values. 20% of post-acquisition income surplus, which is 36,000. 20% of post-acquisition capital surplus, which gives us what, 4,000. Then, because in our illustration, there was some impairment of goodwill, and because we are also valuing NCI using the fair value method, the value of goodwill that is impaired, NCI's portion is brought here as a deduction. It is a deduction because impairments in the value of goodwill represents losses. So when you put everything together, you get a total of 253,560, representing the value of NCI using the fair value method.